intelligence. My name is Raphaël, and I'll be moderating the session. And so the exact title of the session is Artificial Intelligence, Learning to Think. And already in the title, there's a few important concepts. So intelligence, learning, and thinking. But one of these concepts has been particularly influential in artificial intelligence in the last few decades, and this is learning. And so today we'll have two speakers, two experts on telling us all about learning in artificial intelligence, and I'm very much looking forward to these two talks. But before we start, I'll give a short introduction as to why learning is plays such a critical role in artificial intelligence. And so a few decades ago, typical artificial intelligence algorithms would not learn. So they would be what you call hard-coded. So they would be given a series of very specific instructions that they would follow very precisely. And so, for instance, if you had a robotic arm and you wanted it to grab an imaginary glass of water here, you would have to specify it precisely to, say, move 15.3 centimeters to the left, then 2.3 centimeters down, and then close fingers. And this is how you would grab the glass of water. So this was the old school way of doing artificial intelligence. Nowadays, we try to let the algorithm learn by themselves. So the opposite, or this new way, would be to simply give a reward to the algorithm when it reaches the glass of water. And so the robotic arm at first would just move randomly because it doesn't know what to do. So I'll just do random movement. And then by chance, at some point, it may end up in a position where it will grab the glass of water. And then it will get a reward from this grabbing, from this motion. And then it will change its behavior so as to maximize its reward. And then slowly it will learn to grab the glass of water. And then, so at the end, the motion that the robot arm will have learned will be much more resilient to error, because you could, say, displace the arm and it will still be able to grab the water, whereas the precisely programmed arm will have more trouble for this. And so I'll give you one more example as to why this is also very important in practice. And so probably most of you will have heard of Deep Blue, which is this algorithm that was developed by IBM to play chess. And in the late 90s, it won against Garry Kasparov, the then champion of chess. And so at that time, it was the best chess player in the world. And so in 1997, when this event took place, the New York Times printed the following lines. So I'm not quoting yet. So I forget to say, so chess is a very difficult game, but there's a game that is even more challenging for computers than chess, and this is the Chinese game of Go. And so in 1997, the New York Times printed that it may be 100 years before a computer beats humans at playing Go, maybe even longer. And so probably some of you have heard that this year, in 2016, a computer actually bet the best human player at playing Go. And so this was less than two decades after this quote was originally written. And what probably misled this journalist in thinking that it would take so long to beat the game of Go is that the algorithm that were built into Deep Blue, so the chess player, would not learn. So rather, they were given very specific instructions about how to proceed, and this limited its performance. Now, the algorithm that bet the Go player is called AlphaGo, and the key distinction between AlphaGo and Deep Blue is that it was able to learn and to acquire knowledge with every game that it played. And so this allowed the algorithm to perform so much better than Deep Blue could have. And so I hope that this gives you an intuition as to why learning is important, not to just give resilience to, say, a robotic arm, but it also allows algorithms to achieve more than if they would have been hard-coded. And yeah, so on this, I'll let the stage to our two speakers. So we'll have first Professor Versace and then Professor Walsh giving us talks. So as a quick introduction to Professor Versace. So he holds nothing less than two PhDs, one in experimental psychology and one in cognitive neural systems. So it'll give us an overview from both fields. And he's the head and founder of the Neuromorphic Labs at Boston University. And so his lab is concerned with developing learning machines inspired from biology. So I understand both software and hardware. I guess we're going to hear about this now. And he's also very much involved in translating research from academia to market. And so he's the co-founder of a company called Neurala that develops brains for bots. So probably we'll hear about this too. And his work has been featured in dozens of popular science magazines, like The New Scientist and Geek Magazine, to name just a few. And so, yes, it's a great pleasure to have you here, and I look forward to your presentation. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, guys. Can you hear me? Yes. I'm from Italy, so I have to move around, and I'm paralyzed here on the podium, so forgive me. So who of you likes science fiction? Yes. So I was on the plane from Boston to Berlin, and there was a video of the new science fiction movie called, I think, Arrival. And you know, in the trailer, you see this egg-shaped sort of thing hovering on top of people, and you know, obviously they're gonna come and destroy us, right? Because that's what aliens do. So imagine for a second that aliens has an intelligence agency like the CIA of aliens, and all they have access to is YouTube videos. Okay, they are gonna think that Earth is populated mostly by robots, right? Because you see them all over the place. You see flying drones, you see self-driving cars, you see cow-shaped robots that you know go around, and humanoid robots, and so forth. So the truth is different, right? So you walk outside the street of Berlin, you don't see any robots yet. And the issue is the following. There are three main miracles or achievements that have to be addressed before we can see machine walking among us or working with us in the workplace. And I like to call this the mind, the brain, and the body problem. So let's break this down, each one of them. So by body, I mean inexpensive robotic bodies that can be mass manufactured and they can be extremely cheap. And bodies today are cheap. They can be 3D printed, they can be manufactured very quickly, and they can be really inexpensive. And part of the reason why this is the case is because of people like us buying cell phones. So all the sensors of robotic system today can be simulated or can be used by just picking up the hardware that is commonly found on cell phones. Cameras, microphones, accelerometers, and gyroscopes that give us the sense of positioning. Now, when we turn the head, our vestibular system can be manipulated or can be emulated by the same system that allows your phone to turn when you flip it. So the plummeting cost of sensors have made body really, really inexpensive. So that's great. Bodies are cheap. What about the mind of the robots or the algorithms or the software that powers these robots? So I like to put robots in two main categories. The first kind, they have to be controlled by hand. And this is much or 99% of robotic system today. And then the other are robots that are not exactly intelligent, right? And so are we stuck? No, we're not. So there is actually something that we can look at, understand, and copy to create mind for robotic system, and that's the human brain. Each one of us has one functioning in the skull, about 100 billion neurons, 250 trillion synapses. So, you know, touch your head, you have a jewel inside, unmatched by any technology developed on Earth up to today. So this can be studied, and I spent the past 15 years mathematically modeling aspect of the brain, and as I did, thousands of other scientists did in the world. And today we can emulate a good chunk, or a dangerously good chunk, of these algorithms in software, and basically provide robots with a mind or a thinking substrate that can basically substitute the remote control. So how does this brain look like? That's an example, an early example that we have designed with DARPA. DARPA is one of the most adventurous agency in the US. They have funded a crazy project, one of which ended up being the internet, and another one of which was this one, where they basically asked us to build an artificial brain in collaboration with IBM, Hewlett Packard, and so forth. We were doing the software. So each one of these box is a neural network, or today called also deep network, and it's an emulation of a part of a brain. It can be a perception, visual perception, auditory perception, touch perception, navigation components, motor components, or higher thinking components. And so each one of these models is millions of neurons simulated in software. So why is this useful? And one of the agencies we work with is NASA, right? So why NASA, for instance, is interested in this? And let me bring up another movie, which is The Martian. You remember at a certain point that the poor guy was stranded on Mars, and they figure out he can hack one of the rovers and start to talk to Mars. So you remember how excruciating was the communication? You know, it took like, how are you doing, guys? 15 minutes. I'm well, thank you. 15 minutes, okay? That's true. You know, the speed of light divided, you divide that by the distance between Earth and Mars, depending on the orbit, it takes, 10 to 30 minutes to communicate each way, okay? So imagine how a robot can use this sort of delay to navigate around. It's cumbersome. So what NASA wanted from us, what NASA wanted from us was a brain that is able to be installed on a Mars rover where the Mars rover operates completely independent from any human control. So basically a brain by itself. And that's roughly the task, right? So you are on Mars, what you have to do, you have to navigate around, you have to look around you, you have to classify objects, you have to place these objects in a map. As you move, you have to keep a sense of your position. Like if you're walking around Berlin, you want to come back where you came from, or you want to get to places. And in order to do this, you have to maintain your sense of position. You also have to avoid collisions while you do that, right? And you have to do everything local within the brain power that you have. In case of humans, your brain consumes about 20 watts. We will not be able to do that in robots for many, many years. So we had, you know, a processor inside the robot, and everything had to be done locally. No GPS. There is no GPS on Mars, and it has to be done very, very lightweight and on the spot. So the first thing that we want to demystify is that when you build such a system, it's going to be very, very different unless you program it to be exactly like a human. So let me give you a flavor of the way artificial intelligence is bringing this technology today to the market. So imagine that you're building a seeing machine. How would you build it? And the first thing you have to look at is how do humans actually perceive images? So this hotspot here is representing where people fixate during watching a movie. And so you can see that everybody pretty much fixates at the same spot, and then they quickly move their gaze around. Basically everybody moves at the same time or roughly in the same spot. Why is that the case, right? It's important when you design robots to take this into account. And everybody has a sensor in their eye that is made like this. You have a very high resolution in the center of your visual field, and then this resolution falls off at the periphery. And let me give you an example of what this means. So everybody puts their finger, their thumb like this distance, and pick up something to read, a piece of paper. You have to do it, otherwise you don't appreciate it. I'm not going to move until, okay. Cell phone is good, all right? Pick up a piece of paper, and now keep your gaze at the tip of your finger, and without moving the gaze, bring your cell phone just 3 centimeters aside, or the piece of paper, and try to read it, so have something written on it. So you will not be able to read it. You will not be able to resolve the details unless you move your eyes, okay? So this is just to give you an example of how wrong are we when we think that, first of all, that we can see the world in high resolution. It's not true. We are basically blind to everything but just a few degrees in the center of your eye, and then you move your eye and you create a portrait of reality that is high resolution, but you're basically blind to details. But this is more important, where you're building a robot, you don't want to, you want to use these tricks, and that's one of the many tricks that we use, because otherwise, if you will have the same resolution that you have in the center of your eye, everywhere, that would be your brain. So this is an actual calculation that my, one of my professors did. That's what professors do. They have a lot of time, so they say, okay, if my fovea, which is the center of the visual field, will be expanded to everywhere, and I can see everything in high resolution, your brain will actually weigh 5,000 kilos. So imagine this going around with the brain like this, but imagine this in a robot. So that's impossible, and that's exactly what we did. So that's an example of a visual system that looks around. This is obviously the most important object in nature. It's an Italian espresso machine, and a Boston mug, and so forth. So that's an example of such a visual system that has a very high resolution in the middle, and then shifts its attention, and now it's small enough, because we don't have a massive brain, now we can put it on a small robot. And then, you know, that's another example of the same system executing a task in our lab, where it basically wanders around, classifies objects, avoids collisions, and that's the same system that classifies little object. That the video is a little bit sped up, but what you can see is that the center of attention of the robot, pretty much like a human eye, jumps around, is able to pick up objects, classify those objects, put it in a map, and then be able to roam around an environment, maintain his own sense of position, being able to come back, avoid collisions, and so forth. So that was the first time where with NASA we put together a system that is basically emulating the ability, say, of a small mammal like a rat to navigate around and perform a task pretty much like humans would be able to do. So this is pretty unemotional, right? But what's the relationship between what this circuit shows and the way that we feel and the way we can emulate feelings? So first of all, emotions have been studied for many, many years. And I remember one of the first things that I read, I did study psychology. One of the first things that I noticed is that Sigmund Freud, back in the 1895, he was already pioneering the idea of neural networks, right? So you can see here in the project for a scientific psychology, an early sketch of a neural network where these are neurons, these are synapses or the connection between neurons, and this is a cathartic network that actually has emotion attached to it. So fast forward in a few years, this is my CTO. He's a pretty peculiar Russian guy who always smokes the pipe, and his name is Anatoly. And at a certain point, we had to embed emotion in our circuitry. And the reason why we wanted to do that, I think I have a slide later, yes. We wanted to be able to have reinforcement learning. We wanted to be able to tell the robot, good robot, bad robot, and generate sort of the same substrate of feelings that people have when they get reinforced or when they get penalized for their action. And so the math behind that is actually not that difficult. And you can see here an example of a Pavlov conditioning. I don't know if you're familiar with it, but this another Russian scientist figured out that when they give food to a dog, it starts to salivate. You can use other stimuli, such as the ring of a bell, to then substitute for food. So if I give you food and ring in the bell, give you food, ring in the bell, the next time you hear ring in the bell, you start salivating. And that's basically one of the most obvious learning experiment done in the past few decades, and this can be actually supported by very simple mathematics, right? So imagine that you have two neurons, and everybody has 100 billions of these in their brain, and we call them X and Y we call them Y. The synapses or the conjunction between these two elements, right? One can be the bell and the other one can be salivation, can be modeled by a fairly simple equation that is just a multiplication of this activation. So, for instance, in the United States, we have the election coming up soon, right? So if I tell you Trump, what do you say? That is not a bad word, because we are televised. Donald Trump? Anybody? What? What? Say it's... Dirty hands. So if I... Okay, so if I tell you, if I say Donald Trump and all of you say dirty hands, like Donald Trump, Donald Trump, Donald Trump. Okay, now stop. Donald Trump. Okay, so here we go. If we have 100 people times 100 billion neurons, all follow this simple mathematical law, and you have been conditioned. Okay, and it was not my fault. I didn't pick up the words. Donald, if you're listening to this, it wasn't me. All right, in reality, the equation is a little bit more difficult, but it's a variation. So believe me, if you're interested, I can show you the math. But it's a variation of a simple multiplication. Okay, so this can be studied, can be simulated in software. So let me give you an example of this technology into a self-driving car. So what we did here in collaboration with an automotive manufacturer is we use reinforcement learning telling bad car, bad car, bad car, bad car, right? Then after a few iterations, the car drives by itself. All right, so this has been trained to go straight, but then through learning, it was told that they shouldn't run over pedestrians and they should avoid other collisions and so forth. So this is a piece of technology that it's coming. So minds are getting there. We are building the backbone of what artificial intelligence can do and will be able to do or is already doing in a variety of fielded applications. So what about the brain, right? So the brain is very complicated, and 100 billion neurons, 250 trillion synapses, right? Everything contained in the volume of a 2-liter bottle of cola and consuming as much as a light bulb. So this technology is currently unmatched by anything done on Earth. So if we would like to simulate today the human brain power in hardware, what you will need is the equivalent of a room as big as this, full of IBM supercomputer, for instance, and a dedicated nuclear power plant to fuel it, okay? So are we doomed? No, no. And the trick here is that the computer industry is moving by itself for reasons that are completely unrelated to the brain, building processor that resembles the brain. And this is one of the classic story where you're starting to copy Mother Nature if you're willing it or not. So the computer industry has hit a wall, and you cannot just make processor faster. You cannot just run clocks at millions of gigahertz. You're going to burn the chip. And so what they've been starting to do years ago is to parallelize these chips. And you know, if you take this to the extreme, what does it look a chip with many, many, many different independent processors? It looks exactly like a brain. All right, so for reasons that are unrelated to neuroscience, the computer industry is giving us chips that more and more resemble the brain. And one example is Google Tensor. This is pretty recent, but they're basically building coprocessor to accelerate neural network into their data servers, because Google is an AI company, right? You think you're doing web searches, but you're actually feeding their AI engine. Qualcomm is creating a processor called Neural Processing Unit, which is not a CPU, but it's an NPU. Small startup, this one was just sold, it was started by a friend of mine, and was just sold to Intel for $680 million, something like that. Very, very, very good transaction, but Intel is buying this technology, and when Intel buys this technology, it means that everybody's going to have it in the, you know, in the next few years. And a bunch of other companies, NVIDIA, Qualcomm, and so forth and so forth. So all these processors are being produced to support the brain. And so just to give you a scale, if you're looking at the trend in the computer industry, where are we going? So let's take a brain of a mouse, which is you know, half a gram, like about 70 million neurons. So you would think that the mouse is not really, you know, anything particular. But a mouse, if we could today put the brain of a mouse in a robot, we will be golden, right? That's enough brain power to do 90% of the useful stuff that we need. So according to these calculations, in 2020, we might be able to have a chip that consumes about 5 volts and is about 3 square centimeters. So something like this will contain enough computing power to emulate the brain of a mouse in hardware. So this technology is definitely being built and coming. So everything is converging. And one of the biggest factors that you have when a technology becomes mainstream is that you have multiple things happening at the same time. Right? It's like a chemical reaction. So you have the chip bodies, you have the powerful brains, so the processors, and you also have the algorithms available. So this is a critical junction in time that makes 2016 and the neighboring here is very, very special, I would say, for humankind. And yesterday there was a fierce debate on AI, and I know that I'm going to get some of these questions for sure, but let me address some in advance. Is AI coming? Yes, it's coming. So this is not a joke. It's not only, of course, my company. There are thousands of startups and big corporations, right? So when a big corporation adopts AI, the curve of adoption starts to become exponential, which means that if Neurala, which is my company, does it, we're going to reach 100 people or 100,000. But when IBM does it and Oracle does it and so forth, they're going to reach millions of people. So this is one technology that we are today licensing to car manufacturers. And that's another example of another technology that goes into drones. And these are the kind of drones we work with. So they're quadcopters. In this particular case, the drone is substituting a human in an inspection. So as opposed to sending a human up a cell phone tower and up there with the danger of falling down and dying, what companies are starting to do today is to automatize the process of inspections. So you can do it quicker, inspections, you can do it safer, and at a fraction of the cost. Right? So in this particular case, we are taking away the human for safety reasons and for speed reasons. And this is happening across many, many different applications. These are just two examples. So what to do? Do we want to embrace AI? Or do we want to fear it? Right? Should we take the blue pill or the red pill? I already took the pill, so you know where I am. But what should humankind do? And what we're basically doing is introducing a new species. Right? So there is not going to be only plants and other animals around, but we're going to also have machines in our ecosystem operating in the same ecological niche, in the air and crawling or where we live, and are we ready for that? I think so, and this is obviously, with every technology, there are many dangers, and we can talk about that in the debate, but I foresee AI as being a helper of humankind rather than an obstacle, and I think society has very big problems ahead of us, explosion of population and energy and the greenhouse effect, and I think we have to use every possible mean to help us out, and one of these is artificial intelligence that will make everything more efficient. So I welcome AI. I know some of you don't. I'm happy to talk, and thank you, guys.
Well, thank you for this great talk. We'll move right on to our next speaker, and we'll have a joint question session at the end with the two speakers. So Professor Walsh has a PhD in artificial intelligence from the University of Edinburgh, and he now moved to a warmer climate in Australia, where he's a professor of artificial intelligence at the University of Southwestern Australia in Sydney. And he's a fellow of the Australian Academy of Science. And he was named one of the 100 rock stars of the Australian Digital Revolution, nothing less. His work has been featured also in popular science magazines like The New Scientist, American Scientist. And I heard he also has a very popular Twitter account, so one of the top 10 accounts to follow to keep abreast with development in AI. But we're fortunate enough to have the man himself today, so no need to follow an account. And we look forward to the talk. Thank you.
Thank you. It's great to see so many people here interested to find out more about AI. So when I was a young boy, I obviously read far too much science fiction, Arthur C. Clarke, Isaac Asimov, and one thing that it's true about science fiction is it's full of robots and intelligent machines. And there's a very good reason that's the case. It's because that's our future. Our future is full of robots and intelligent machines, and that future seems to be rushing towards us very quickly. So it's a really exciting time to be, as it was introduced, to be a professor of AI, working on trying to build some of this technology. When I started 30 years or so ago working, trying to build intelligent machines, everyone said, oh, it's a waste of time, you're never going to succeed. And today, interestingly enough, people say, wait a second, you're going to succeed. And people are starting to get worried about what that means. And so I want to talk about what that means and whether we should be worried and where this is all going to end up. So the title is The Singularity. And if you stay around to 5 o'clock, there's a really good film you can watch about the singularity. And I'll tell you in a second what the singularity is. But certainly there's a lot of very smart people who have started to worry about where this is all going to end. And one of the smartest people who said that was Stephen Hawking, who said to the BBC just over a year ago, and he repeated it actually a couple of weeks ago again at another event, that he thought that the development of full artificial intelligence could spell the end of the human race, which is, for someone as smart as Stephen Hawking, that's quite a worrying prospect, right? And he's not the only person. There's lots of other people. Elon Musk, the founder of Tesla, you know, someone who knows technology, right? He's disrupting the world with his autonomous cars, with his SpaceX program, you know, someone who is a great technologist. And he's put his finger on as AI being the thing that we shouldn't be most worried about. It's potentially our biggest existential threat, and that we might be summoning the demon. And so I'm spending a lot of my time now trying to help inform people about, you know, where we should be worried about, what we should be worried about. And I think there's quite a lot of misconception about where this is all going to end. So I'm going to hopefully try and help dispel some of this misconception in the next 20 minutes. Now, a lot of this misconception comes down to this idea, the title of my talk, the singularity, or the technological singularity. This is an idea that has been popularized by many people. There's a New York Times bestseller by Nick Bostrom and other people have written and prophesized about how this moment in history that's going to come quite soon, they predict. Ray Kurzweil, the futurologist who works at Google, has predicted that it will happen around 2045. This is the idea that, well, okay, we're going to be building, as we heard earlier, we're going to be building machines that have intelligence. Right? Well, at some point, we're going to build a machine that's so intelligent that it can redesign itself. So it's more intelligent. Now, that more intelligent machine can obviously then redesign itself again. And then this is a tipping point. This is a snowball moment where the machines get smarter and smarter and smarter. And because they're not held back by our slow biological limitations, they're not held back by the speed of evolution. They can reproduce from generation to generation much more quickly than us. They're not held back by our biology. Our brains, as we heard, work in hertz, and whereas computers, we keep on turning the clock speed up, we keep on giving them more memory. That they're not going to be held back by our biological limitations. And so very quickly, they'll become as smart as us, and then they'll become, shortly after that, much smarter than us. And then we'll no longer be the smartest things on the planet. And if there's one thing that's true, is that we are the dominant species, for better or for worse, on this planet, because we're the smartest species. In fact, it's so important, it's in our name, Homo sapiens. We're the smart race, right? And we've become dominant over all the other animals on the and organisms on this planet because we're smart. There are many other creatures that are faster than us, that are stronger than us, that have got sharper teeth than us. But there was nothing that was as intelligent as us, and we've used that to build tools and to control the environment and to become in the position that we are on this planet. So if we create something that's smarter than us, how's that going to end for us? How's that going to end for mankind? Now, I actually want to question the very basis of this argument, that we will necessarily end up at this tipping point where the machines just take off and we become, in some sense, redundant from them. Okay, and I'm going to give you six reasons. I only got five fingers, but I've got six reasons to tell you why it's not going to be as simple as that. Now, I'm not going to argue that we're not going to build intelligent machines. We are surely going to build intelligent machines. We can already build machines if we pick a very narrow domain in which they're very smart. We heard in the introduction that we've already beaten humankind at the ancient Chinese board game of Go. And that, I can assure you, I've played a couple of games very badly, is the Mount Everest of board games. We can build, if we have a narrow enough focus, we can build machines that do that task, that intelligent task, very well. But what you have to realize is, at the moment, they're idiot savants. They're very good at one narrow, focused, specialized task. And there's nothing that approaches the breadth of ability of the human brain, and there's still a lot to admire about the human brain. Right? So one of the stories was, you heard, the reason that AlphaGo got to be so good at Go was that it learned. It played itself millions, in fact, actually billions of games of Go. And it got so good at playing Go that it's now better than any human. But what people don't realize in that story, that there was a small victory also for mankind. Because Lee Sedol, one of the best Go players in the world, one of the two best Go players in the world that AlphaGo was playing, he lost the first three games against AlphaGo. And AlphaGo was playing a new type of Go, but certainly the opening moves of the Go game, Go masters have said they've never seen moves played like that before. And so that's really exciting for them to explore how Go, the game of Go, a new player's played the game of Go. So it's going to be a really interesting journey for the next 10 or 20 years, like it was with chess after Kasparov was beaten by Deep Blue, that the machines will teach us new things about the game itself. But anyway, AlphaGo was playing a new type of Go, and Lee Sedol played three games of Go. And on the fourth game, he beat AlphaGo. And that just shows you, if the machines are very smart, AlphaGo, though, had played billions of games of Go. If you started playing Go the moment you were born, and you played Go for every moment of your life until you died, you wouldn't have played that many number of games of Go. So AlphaGo is a bit of a slow learner, whereas mankind, or at least I'm claiming credit for Lee Sedol here, is a very quick learner. In three games of Go, we learned how to play against AlphaGo. So there was a small victory there for mankind. Okay, so back to why we don't have to worry about the machines just being able to improve themselves recursively and then becoming necessarily much smarter than us. Okay, so the first one is called the faster thinking dog argument. Now this is the wonder of the internet, right? I know if you type into Google or your favorite search engine, silly looking dog, you'll get a plethora of pictures of funny looking dogs. So this is the argument. Well, one of the reasons that people believe that we're going to get smarter machines is that, as I mentioned, machines are not limited by our biology. Until recently, Moore's law meant that every 18 months to 2 years, machines got twice as fast, they got twice as much memory, twice as many transistors on the chip. So if we can get a machine that's intelligent as us, of course, Moore's law and improvements in computing will mean that we'll get faster, more parallel chips. Where is it going to end? Now, this argument is, well, suppose I could turn up in some way, some magic way, I could turn up the clock speed of my dog. Well, I'm afraid my dog is still not going to be able to play chess. It will just be a dog. It doesn't have the mental constructs, the language, all the other things that are built into our intelligence. It's not just about turning up the clock speed. Our intelligence is much more about that. It's about years of experience and training. There's much more than just being able to turn up the clock speed. So just because computers may be faster, may have more memory, is not by itself going to give us intelligence? Okay, the second one, second argument, is one of anthropocentricity. It's the fact that we're again putting ourselves somehow in the center of the universe. And one thing we should have learned from the history of science, from Copernicus, who said, wait a second, the sun doesn't go around the earth. We're not at the center of the universe. And Darwin, that we're different. We're different to the apes. We're just derived from the same biological roots as the apes. Right? Every time we've put ourselves on a pedestal and said there's something special about us, we've been wrong, and we should have been learning a bit more humility. And so saying that there's something special about our human-level intelligence, that some special point that you have to pass, is again, I suspect, saying there's something a little too special about ourselves. Human-level intelligence, well, first of all, what is human-level intelligence? This room is full of people with varying levels of intelligence. There's no doubt people in the room who are more intelligent than me and people perhaps who aren't as intelligent as me. So it's a spectrum of intelligences, right? So what does it mean to pass human-level intelligence? It's not one point on a line. But even so, the average intelligence, the most intelligent person on the planet, doesn't matter. If we say that there's something special about our level of intelligence, I suspect we're again putting ourselves on that little pedestal that we should discover is a little too special. Okay, the third argument, and this is a very subtle one. This is a bit more subtle, but I really like this argument. It's what's called the meta-intelligence argument, is that this whole idea about recursive self-improvement is confusing two very subtly different properties. One is our ability to learn how to do a task well. We can write a program that learns how to play Go very well. We've done that. But that doesn't mean we can learn about learning how to do a task. That program, AlphaGo, wasn't able to improve its speed of learning Go. That's a meta-level task above it. And there's a nice analogy to be made here, which is if we think about ourselves, we understand so much more about our neurophysiology, and yet we can't learn really that much quicker than 100 years ago. If you have to learn a foreign language, it's still just as painful as it always was. We haven't got that much better, despite our great understanding of how the brain works, in learning. It's still just as painful to learn. And so, similarly with our machines, they may be able to learn a particular task, but they won't be able to learn how to learn better at those tasks. Okay, and the fourth argument, and that's one that many of my colleagues working in AI are very familiar with, is one of diminishing returns. And this says, well, suppose even if we can get to this nice moment of recursively self-improving the machines, and we keep it, the machine gets better and better, there are many, many tasks in which we've been able to repeatedly improve things, but each time it gets a bit harder. And so, for example, if each time you can get 50% better, and then 50% better again on that, and then 50% better again on that, that infinite sequence we know has a finite limit. You'll only ever double the intelligence you have. So there are many tasks where we've got better and better improvement, but we've run into bottlenecks. Finally, and not finally, actually, penultimately, there may be just some fundamental limits to intelligence. We certainly have discovered in almost every other area of science that there are fundamental limits. You can't travel faster than the speed of light. You can't look at things with finer resolution than quantum limits impose upon you, the quantum uncertainty of as you get very small. So there are many limits we come against. Some of them may be, you know, hard physical limits like the speed of light. They may also be just things that emerge out of the complexity of our brains or of whatever you build that's going to be intelligence, that we just may run into some complexity bottlenecks. And they may just be limits about the uncertainty of the universe. It doesn't matter how long I think about today's lottery, I'm not going to be able to predict the numbers that come up in the lottery any better by thinking about the problem any longer. There's just the uncertainty of the universe will limit the quality of the decision I can make. And then the final argument, much more technical argument, is that we certainly, as a computer scientist, there are fundamental limits as to the complexity of problems that we can solve. And even if you tell me that you're going to get exponential improvements, everyone's taken away by how exponentials are going to solve problems. But I can give you lots of computational problems where exponentials don't grow fast enough, where the complexity grows much faster than exponentially. And so there are fundamental questions that come from the computational complexity that suggest, unless we move to radically different models of computation, and even models like quantum computing are not going to be enough, we're not going to be able to break through these barriers. So anyway, that's half a dozen reasons why myself, and actually many of my colleagues working in AI, aren't particularly worried that we'll wake up one morning and suddenly there'll be a more intelligent species on the planet. And that suddenly the machines have overnight been able to improve themselves and maybe they're going to start taking over the planet. I do think we will build very intelligent machines and they won't be as limited as they are today by working in very narrow domains, but we're going to have to work on that ourselves. We're going to have to engineer that. We're going to have to do much of the building of that ourselves. And so it's not going to happen overnight. It's going to happen over the matter of decades or perhaps even centuries. And I'd be very disappointed by the end of the century. I'm going to be very disappointed by the end of the century because I'm not going to be alive. But I'll be very disappointed by the end of the century if we don't have machines that are as intelligent as us. But it's not something where we're going to suddenly wake up and discover that. We're going to have to do a lot of work and programming and engineering and so on. But certainly, given the billions of dollars that's being poured into the field today, I'm reasonably confident we're going to get there and we're making really good progress. That doesn't mean that I don't think there are many things that we should be worrying about, many more pressing problems that we should be worrying that technology is going to be bringing. And I'll just mention two of those very quickly before I finish. So I don't think it's going to be a technological singularity, but we will eventually get to intelligent machines. And there are a couple of things I do think we should worry about. One that the media calls, which is killer robots, or building machines, or lethal autonomous weapons, to call the technical term, that we will be putting robots into the battlefield. And whenever I talk about these sorts of things, people put up, like I did, a picture of Terminator. But that's actually not what I think we should be worried about. That's a misconception. Something like Terminator, that's, you know, waiting for us if we make a few poor decisions out at the end of the century. There are actually much more pressing things that are going to happen in the next few years. And this is the sort of thing we should be worrying about. This is a drone. This is not autonomous. This is flown by remote control. There's a soldier in a container back in Arizona or Nevada who's flying this thing, who's making that final life or death decision to let off that Hellfire missile that you see being fired there. But it's a very small technical leap to take that human, that soldier, who's flying that, who's making that life or death decision, out of the loop and replace them by a computer. In fact, even the UK's Ministry of Defence have said they think it's technically possible today, and they're right. And there are prototypes of these sorts of machines being built today by many of the major militaries. In fact, in every sphere, on the land, on the sea, under the sea, and in the air, there are prototype autonomous weapons being developed by the US military, by the Chinese military, by the Russian military, the Israeli military, the UK military, and there is an arms race, even if you don't realize it, there is an arms race going on to develop these technologies. And at the moment, they're too stupid. And they will be killing all the wrong people. And even when they're killing the right people, this is going to be what has been called the third revolution in warfare. It is going to totally transform the efficiency with which we can kill the other side. And it's going to be a disastrous turn for mankind. But we get to choose whether these technologies get used for good or bad. It's pretty much the same technology that's going to go into one of these weapons, that's going to go into your autonomous car, that's going to save the million road fatalities that will happen on the world in the next year. And so there are good uses for the technology, like making our roads safer, and there are bad uses for the technology, like putting them into weapons like this. And we get to make those choices. The United Nations in 3 weeks' time comes together in Geneva to decide whether to move to the next stage in actually putting together a ban on this, and I very much hope that they do. I'll be going to Geneva to talk to the diplomats there about this. But that's something we have to worry about very immediately. In fact, it's giving rather stupid machines the responsibility of life and death. And then the second area that I think we really have to worry about is what's called technological unemployment. That increasingly, many of the more mundane and less, and some less mundane jobs are being replaced by automation. So to give you an example, autonomous vehicles are coming very soon. In fact, you can buy a Tesla today that will drive on the highway, at least, autonomously. And within the next 10 or 20 years, there are going to be autonomous trucks. There are two trials in Pittsburgh, in Singapore today, of autonomous taxis. If you're a taxi driver, if you're a truck driver, your job is on the way out. And it's going to be so much, not only is it going to be so much safer, as I mentioned, it's going to be so much more efficient. It's going to transform the economics of transportation. There's good benefits. The young, the elderly, the disabled, they're all going to be given personal mobility. But at the same time, all of those jobs are very much likely to go. Now, this is a debate not for just for people like myself, technologists. I can tell you what's going to be technically possible in the next 20 years. But this is a debate for the whole of society. How are we going to prepare ourselves? How are we going to change our society to deal with this radical change? This, I believe, is going to be as radical a change as the Industrial Revolution. And it's going to happen probably quicker than the Industrial Revolution. And when we had the Industrial Revolution, we changed our world in radical ways. We introduced the welfare state in many first world countries. We introduced universal education to prepare people, to give them jobs. We introduced pensions. We introduced lots of things to make sure that it wasn't how Marx said, that the owners of the means of production were going to inherit all the wealth. And we need to think radically about how we prepare our society and how we transition into a world with many challenges. And we had them mentioned earlier, the global financial crisis, the global warming, the global refugee problem, all of these problems facing our society. And if there's one thing that's going to help us cure them, it's technology, in particular information technology, particular automation. But we also can make the wrong choices and end up where the wealth is concentrated into the hands of the owners of the robots and not into the hands of all of us, and in which the inequality will increase. So it's really great that we're having these sorts of discussions now. I think it's a great moment in time that we should. And I think I thank you for your attention.
So thank you for another great talk. So since you brought the subject already, I think I'd like to dive into this this controversy of the use of artificial intelligence for military purposes. So Professor Walsh, you've initiated an open letter calling for the ban of these autonomous weapons. So just to make it clear, what we mean by autonomous weapons is weapons that could take the decisions by themselves to fire a missile or to kill someone. So not simply one that is remotely piloted, but someone, a robot that really takes a decision. And yeah, so the open letter has attracted thousands of signatures, also from very prominent scientists, and you've presented it also at the United Nations. Yes. On the other hand, so Professor Versace, you're partly funded by the American military. And so you're also involved with the American Air Force research and the Pentagon. And so in the sense, you're working towards bringing AI to military purposes and something that could eventually bring these autonomous weapons. And so I'd be very curious to hear both of your point of view on, so what is the place of AI in military? Because probably it's not a clear defined line that it should completely banned or completely accepted. There's probably a place that should be found there. So
yeah, can I start? So yes. So last year I did help to put together this letter that's been signed by thousands. Now has over 20,000 signatures. Some of them are people like Stephen Hawkins that we already mentioned. But I think what was much more interesting is that is that when I put the letter out, I got 1,000 of my colleagues, leading AI researchers in academia and also in all the big companies like Google, Facebook, Microsoft, who signed this letter. So many of my colleagues came together and said, yes, let's make sure that AI is used for good, not for, for bad purposes. Now, you mentioned, of course, that the US military have been a great funder of AI research. In fact, historically, they've been the biggest funder of AI research over the last 40 or 50 years. Now, when people mention this, I actually like to point out there's many really great uses of AI in the military sphere. There's absolutely no reason that we should risk anyone's life clearing a minefield. That's a job for a robot. You know, if it goes wrong, the robot gets blown up, everyone's happy. There's no reason that we should ever risk people's lives bringing military convoys, military supplies into contested territory. We should use autonomous vehicles to do that. We shouldn't risk anyone's lives. And there are defensive weapon systems. There's things like the Phalanx anti-missile system that defends a ship against incoming missiles. That's an autonomous weapon, but it's actually just a defensive weapon, and it's not used in offensive capacity. So there's lots of great things I think the military should be using weapon systems for, but whether we should have an arms race about offensive weapons, I really hope the planet comes together and makes a conscious decision to say that, no, this is technology where the world would be a better place if we didn't have it. And we've actually made that same decision in a number of other technologies. We have limited the use of biological and chemical weapons. To a certain extent, we've limited the use of nuclear weapons, anti-personnel mines, blinding lasers. There's a number of technologies where we've come together and said, actually, no, it'd be probably better and more humane if we didn't develop this technology for military ends. And the planet has come together and made it a consensual agreement not to field this sort of technology in the battlefield. And I'm very much hopeful that we would do the same thing here.
Mm-hmm. So much of my research was funded by, a good chunk of my research was funded by the US military. And if you put NASA as military, the trick is that this research has dual purpose, right? So everything that I have done has gone into commercial applications and peaceful application. And despite I've visited the Pentagon several times, talking to military, I don't even have US citizens, if you believe it or not. I am 15 years in the United States. I still have my Italian passport. But the military needs to know, needs to be updated and needs to tap into the scientists and the technologists to know what's coming, right? So none of my system, none of my my technology is equipping any military device as of today, and I just want to point that out. But this will change. I don't know if about my technology, but if it's not my company, it will be another company. And if it's not in the United States, it will be in China, in Russia. And as was mentioned before, everything points to the fact that everybody is developing these technologies, right? So there will be a predator that can take a missile and shoot it automatically. So automatic targeting system. And it's the same exact technology that goes into self-driving cars and ground robots and so forth. And the inevitability of this technology is clear if you think of a reason that is very simple, which is the so-called one-to-one mapping between human operator and drones. So the drone that was shown on the screen is beyond that. It needs 300 humans to operate, right? So the predator, if you sum up the ground, the people at the ground station, maintenance, and the people who are actually looking at the sensors of this predator, you get to 300 people. And you don't want that, right? There is not enough people to man all the machines in the world. So you need to get them independently. And then the boundary between being able to analyze everything in the scene and be able to fire a missile when an enemy is seen is very, very narrow. And it's not a technological barrier. It's a moral barrier. And I think that's the reason why morality should be involved, especially today when these machines are true and they're getting there. I think it's really, really important in the field so that that military is not taking control of this technology without a lot of oversight.
So I think I just want to pick up that point, which is dual use is the ethical challenge that we have here. It's really pretty much the same technology that's going to go into your autonomous car that's going to be able to track, target, and avoid pedestrians, as it's going to go into your autonomous drone that's going to be able to track, target, and kill combatants on the ground. And we're not going to... We're going to want to have that technology because it's going to make our roads so much safer. It's going to improve our lives in so many ways. But there's nothing stopping us, if we choose, using the same technology for bad ends. But that's a moral choice that we as a society get to make. Mm. And we've seen this in the past. I mean, you know, nuclear technology. It can be used to make nuclear bombs, or it can be used to make nuclear power, which, you know, some people think is, you know, one of the greenest forms of power we could have. You know, most technologies... can be used for good or bad. And, you know, the technology itself is morally neutral. And it's a decision that actually society has to make.
Thank you. So we are at a point where the technology is here, and so the moral of a scientist would tell us that we should avoid using these autonomous weapons, perhaps. Let's hope that the politician's moral will follow suit to the scientists. So I'd like to open up on a different topic. So regarding the theme of the festival, so the theme of this festival is the emotion, the sentimental machines. And so we humans and animals have very strong emotions, and they play an important role for our cognition. And so, for instance, we are able to take much quicker decisions based on our emotions and our gut feeling. And also for memory, emotions are important, so we are much likelier to remember a sad or a happy event, and this will help us take better decisions in the future. And so if emotions are important for biological intelligence, you would think that emotions may also be beneficial for artificial intelligence. And so do you think that one day we will be able to reverse engineer such emotions into machines for the better of these machines?
Okay, clearly, emotions are a significant part of our lives, and evolution has you know, allowed emotions to develop, and they seem to play, as you mentioned, you know, a very critical component, especially in our, you know, quite reactive decision making. So it seems likely that, you know, if we're going to develop intelligence in machines, that they may actually have to have emotional lives of their own. I mean, it's very clear that they're going to be able to have to understand emotions. I mean, just so people don't get worried, computers have no emotions at the moment, and they have very poor understanding of our emotions. But we're going to spend more and more of our lives interacting with machines, and so they're going to have to understand our emotions. They're going to have a better interaction with us. They're going to have to understand our emotions. So, you know, people ask me, what's my favorite AI movie? Well, it's a very small category of favorite AI movies, because most of them paint such a dystopian view of the future. But there's one AI movie that I quite like, which was the movie Her, where it was all about, you know, the AI was disembodied. It was just a voice, right? There was no physical manifestation. But it was, that's how AI is going to be in your future. It's going to be your operating system, the way you interact with computers in the future. And, you know, that machine's going to know more about you than perhaps even your spouse. They're going to know your preferences, the things you do. They're going to know so much more about you. And, you know, you're going to start, you know, we very quickly ascribe feelings and emotions to our cars. I'm sure we're going to be ascribing feelings and emotions to this machine that, you know, we converse with from the moment we wake up to the moment we go to sleep, and that understands us and arranges our lives and does all these things. So we're going to have a richer and richer emotional relationship with our machines. Maybe we'll put simulated emotions in there to begin with, because that will make us relate to them better. But maybe, we don't know. We don't know enough about emotions to know whether we'll actually engineer them to have something in some sense, a real emotion, or whether it's just a simulated emotion. Whether it's good enough just to have a simulated emotion, or whether it will really have real emotional states.
Yeah, so let me share a story with you. Talking about simulated emotion, it was 2009, and we were doing this big project with DARPA called the DARPA Synapse Project, which was basically building a brain, a simulated brain, right? And me and my colleague, we start designing this, you know, little rat brain, and then we put the rat brain into this virtual environment and then say, okay, it's time for the brain to explore the environment. And then we looked at each other and say, crap. The rat doesn't do anything. We have to program something. And we sat down and designed basically a curiosity. We call the curiosity drive, or basically we encoded a piece of the brain that in rats is responsible for being curious and explorative, right? So we built, I don't know if you call this emotion, but we built something that is not the same as perceiving a pair or a person. And then, you know, we built other parts of the circuit of the mammal that have nothing to do with perception or, you know, the sort of things that you see AI doing, but have much to do with emotions and reinforcement and feelings. So I don't think there is a mathematical or a technological barrier to be able to emulate. You know, if you look at your cerebral cortex, the circuit in it are the same or very similar. You know, there is nothing special that I know of neurons that code your emotions versus neurons that code red or movement, right? So it's neurons are neurons and neurons. So you can model mathematically those neurons, you can model the other ones. So I think you can do it, you can model emotions.
Can I ask you a question?
Yes.
Are we going to have to model the chemistry?
Yeah, so that's interesting. In my PhD thesis, I had cholinergic modulation, which is basically, you know, if you're sipping coffee, you're basically stimulating your acetylcholine modulations, and I did that in software. Now, that's software, right? So, and this goes into philosophy. Like, am I actually sure that the machine feels or as the equivalent of a human experience of emotion or cholinergic modulation and so forth? I don't have the answer. And to tell you the truth, I don't care at this particular point, as long as the machine works, because that's what people ask us, right? They're not worried about the machine having feelings. People working with us, they want to know, is your stuff working or not, right?
But it's important if they really have feelings, because then they may have moral rights. Then we're not allowed to turn them off. Then we have to give them, you know, some legal status within our society.
I'm all for it. And my another favorite movie is the Centennial Man, which is with I'm blocking on the name of the actor who recently passed away.
Yeah,
Robin Williams. Robin Williams. That's a fabulous movie. I don't know. I will show this at the festival. When the person starts to become, you know, basically he did the transition from AI to human. And that's a beautiful movie. That's moving. And I'm all for giving rights to robots. You know, let's sign a petition.
Thank you. So machines that may one day have emotions, it remains a question whether it'll be the same emotions, whether they feel the same way that we do feel.
Yeah, well, I mean, there's the hard problem, right? Consciousness, whether they will actually ultimately have consciousness. And then, you know, these things that we talk about, like moral rights.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, very interesting. So maybe there would be a good time to open up for questions to the audience. We have two microphones on each side, so if maybe someone wants to go up and have a question, I'm sure there will be many from such a... Was there a question here, or are you standing for?
No, I'm just... I'll okay. Hand it to someone who wants to ask one.
Thank you for the nice presentations. My question concerns the copyright patenting regulation of AI, and I would be curious to hear your opinions about if AI should be as open as possible, like open source or something like this, for everyone to develop, or should it be that companies can have very closed systems, or should it be regulated by authorities?
Okay. So there is much in the market as open source AI, right? And you might want to ask yourself what to wish for, right? So if you open up AI, you make it possible for everybody to be developing AI much quicker. Is that what you want? Who asked the question? Is that what you want? Yeah, no. It depends what you want, right? So if you want to accelerate the future, open up of AI source code, which is already there. I mean, there is a chunk of code open. You know, we'll accelerate AI. It will make it possible for everybody to do it. So it's not in the hands of the powerful, but it's in the hands of everybody. So there are 10,000 startups. There can be 100,000 startups that are going to develop AI, and God knows what they're going to do. So it's something that can be done, but I don't know what is the consequence of it.
So it's a great question, because I think it's one of these questions that we have to really worry about. And I think people are much more worried about it on this side of the Atlantic than they are on the other side of the Atlantic. And it's certainly the case that the technology is being concentrated at the moment into the hands of a few large corporations, the Googles, the Facebooks of the world, who have the resources, the data, the server farms to actually run some of these things today. And it's not clear whether all of us are going to be able to therefore profit or benefit from what the technology is going to bring us. I mean, there is this initiative that Elon Musk was one of the people behind, called the OpenAI Initiative, which is trying to open up the technology. But it's not clear to me whether we're going to have to, you know, this is in the past where we've had large concentrations of technology in the hands of people, we've, you know, broken up these cartels just because it's not healthy to have that. And it's not clear to me that it's healthy necessarily to let just the large corporations decide what's going to happen. I mean, so example, I had a journalist ring me up yesterday talking about Uber is offering taxi rides to go and vote on Tuesday in the US election. Now, that sounds like, you know, on the surface, that sounds like a really good thing, right? You know, we want greater representation, and we certainly want, you know, the millennial generation who perhaps feel a bit disenfranchised from the election process to be encouraged to participate in an open election like that. But what if you then discover that they're actually offering taxi rides preferentially to people who are going to vote for the Democratic Party? You know, it's not so clear that they're necessarily participating in a democratic process anymore. You know, there's a certain transparency, and you know, these corporations now are as big as small countries. They wield the power, the economic might, and they're certainly, it's not clear that their values are completely aligned with our values. Certainly, if you look at the way they decide to organize their taxation fairs, they are not clearly aligned with the values of the broader society. So, yeah, I'm concerned where this will end up, and necessarily whether there has to be some sort of regulation, just as there has been for many other types of technology. In the telecom companies, they were regulated. The large corporations, typically, you know, you don't want the... you don't want things to be concentrated into the hands of too few people.
Hi, thanks so much for the discussion this morning. A couple of questions. One is for me always the sort of why. And I think we humans have this extraordinary thing encoded in us, which is by nature makes us survive. So even though there's millions of people living under horrendous conditions, suicide rates are actually relatively low because we have this sort of survival mechanism built in us. What would a computer stop to just unplug himself? Like, what is the... Why would robots want to take over the world? Like, there is no encoding in them necessarily to not just be evil, that's a whole other thing, we could do that, but, like, to keep staying alive. Like, what... I don't see the point. What is the why, and why would that happen? And have you ever thought about that? Because there's no life in them as sort of a DNA construct.
Well, I'm gonna bring up an equation. Very simple. Is human equal to AI, or is AI equal to human? Right now, no. But 10 years from now, maybe. And if the equation holds, then maybe they're going to have the same instincts and the same sort of feelings or the same instinct of survival that we have. So I don't think it can be ruled out that the machine will, at a certain point, you know, emulate also this capacity of the human brain. And as we'll say, that, you know, 100 years from now, you know, we're going to be able to beat the Go player, and that's happened. Right? So I cannot rule that out. Logically, I can't.
You know, it's a wonderful question. Most things I think you should be worried about is not malevolence, that we're going to build some machine that's suddenly going to say, oh, why, you know, I don't want to be turned off. I want to, you know, consume the resources of the planet. It's actually incompetence. We'll build machines that by mistake, they will have side effects that we don't really anticipate.
Oops.
And, you know, so it's not necessarily we're going to build an evil machine, but one that, you know, there'll be some unfortunate side effect. We already have this today. You know, we have flash crash. We have the fact that we, you know, most of the trading on our stock markets is done by machine, and we don't build enough circuit breakers in there. There's unfortunate feedbacks between these machines, and the stock prices collapse. Well, you know, suppose I build a trading algorithm, and it works out that if it starts a minor war in Africa, stock prices are going to, you know, of technology companies, military technology companies are going to go up. Well, they might decide it's best to, you know, put out a tweet saying a small war has started in an African country. And maybe a small war will start by mistake if you put the right tweet out. So, you know, we didn't intend it to be, but that, you know, the machine had the wrong effect. But, you know, I think what's really interesting about your question, though, is the one about the life spirit. Because at the end of the day, you know, will we be machines that will have some sort of life spirit? Or is it enough just that we give them some big goal, like, you know, make as much money as you can on the stock market, and it will realize to do that, it has to make sure it's never turned off. And so it will make sure it's never turned off. You know, and it will jump from server to server, making sure that it's doing its goal, and that's not what we intended, but that's what will happen.
Great, thank you. A second question, just I'm really happy to hear you going to speak in Geneva at the UN. The question around that is, like, do you really perceive AI to be the biggest threat right now? I've just spent a lot of time on the West Coast, and what I've seen is happening with CRISPR technologies, and also the cost at actually running a little wet lab for pretty much anyone and tinkering with human biology, for me, seems the far bigger threat at this point in time, especially given what's happening in China.
I'm going to disagree with your question, the premise of your question, which is that we need to decide which is the bigger threat, right? I think they're both non-trivial threats that we have to think about. You're right. I mean, these sorts of things are very dangerous technologies as well, and so we have to be worried about them. And it's not just the cost of the technology. I mean, we've had biological weapons for a long time now. We've had chemical weapons. They're all cheap technologies. So it's not just the cheapness of the technology that's a matter. I think we have to be very worried about all of these things. And there is, you can you know, go look on YouTube. You can see videos of all of these prototypes, you know, an autonomous ship, autonomous submarine, autonomous drone being developed by the US and Chinese, Russian militaries today. And so it's very clear there's an arms race going on. I'm not an expert, I'm afraid, on these biological ones, but it's clear that the technology is accessible enough that we should be worried about those things as well.
So yesterday I was having a glass of wine in the afternoon and ended up in a debate that was funny, but, well, not so funny. So they were talking about self-driving cars, and it was a board saying, big question, who is responsible, right? And the first line there was the software coder, right? I am responsible if the self-driving car crashes into somebody, right? So I started to be in this debate, and one of these person, which I don't know if he's in the audience, but he asked a very probing question, and it was mixed, if I have to recall his eyes. His eyes had a mix of rage and fear. When he asked me the question, I say, why? Why are you doing this? This is dangerous, right? And, you know, on the moment, I felt like, okay, why I do it, you know, I was studying psychology, I like the brain, I'm an inquiring mind, and if you ask why I do that, it's because that's what I like to do. You know, I like to, you know, as you like to do your job, I like to do my job. It ends up that my job you know, is to build artificial intelligence. And but then I went to the hotel and I thought about it. You know, so, and the morale question is really probing. And for a second, I did a thought experiment because I had jet lag and I couldn't sleep. Right, and I thought, what if I'm not a human for a second, and I am a ball of light, hovering 1,000 kilometers above Earth, and I'm eternal. So I look down and I see the dinosaur and the extinction, and then I see humans, Homo sapiens, coming up and basically destroying everything on the planet, apart from a few areas, and doing disasters, enslaving other species for eating them, all right, destroying plants and so forth. And I said, wow, we are the big problem. And so I thought, maybe all this debate about AI will help humankind to define what is morality.
Thank you.
So we are basically fucked up as a species. And I think we are the problem, not the machines. And maybe another side conference in Geneva would be about morality of people rather than machines.
Well, it's interesting. I just came from a workshop which was entitled Moral Machines, talking to philosophers about, could you make machines with morals? And, you know, we can't today. That's absolutely certain. We have no idea how you could program a machine with morality. Yet, in 20 years' time, machines will for sure be making life or death decisions which have deep moral consequences. And so we will have to have worked out how to make moral machines. I mean, they may not have morality in the sense that they are human morality, but they'll have to be making decisions which have an immense moral effect. And so that will certainly inform our understanding of morality.
So we have one more question on this side.
Yeah. Hi, thanks very much for your presentation. I think that we need to apply a finer resolution to the concepts that we're using. So in particular, I think we need to distinguish between personhood and the biological entity or organism that supports personhood. I think it makes sense to a certain extent to talk about AI being equivalent to, in some sense, a biological entity, whether that's the brain or something else. But we are in danger of making a category error if we're talking about AI being synonymous with personhood, mainly because the concept of personhood is one which is embedded within a discourse that involves society and politics and many other kind of areas which are not reducible straightforwardly, I think, to scientific concepts.
I'm not sure there's a question. I think we may agree with you that you have to be very careful of these category errors to be made. But yeah, I think the challenge I see is that we've made the society today with a number of, actually, I mean, we already have other actors in our society that have great intelligence, immense power, much more power than we do as humans, and have some sort of legal status, and those are corporations. And we're already discovering, for example, today, corporations aren't necessarily making the right moral decisions. They have different sense of morality than we do as humans, and how we make sure that they line up so that society works well. And I think if we introduce a third actor, which will be in a different category, AI machines, they'll have probably immense intelligence, immense power, and they'll be shaping our society, and we have to make sure that their values line up with ours, because otherwise we'll be, society will be that much poorer for it.
I totally agree, and I'll end with a note. You know, there is a lot of negativity about AI, but I think, I personally feel fortunate to be born in a time where this is happening. You know, it's one of the, I agree with you, they're different. You know, machine will be different, but that's awesome. You know, let's figure this out. And we'll need the brightest mind to figure this out. And, you know, if I wasn't here at this point, I would be pissed.
Yeah, well, I mean,
this is a great time to be around.
We have to remember the last 50 years of economic growth have largely come about because of automation, in particular information technology. If it weren't for that information technology, our prosperity would not have increased. We would not be living, wealthier, healthier lives that we do today. That most of the economic advances that we've had have come through technology, and particularly through information technology. And so in the next 50 years, if we're going to see, if we're even just going to be able to tackle the problems facing us, let alone actually try and help the third world lift its prosperity, even give our children as good lives as we've had, we're going to need technology, and we're going to need things like AI to help us get out of the deep holes that we've already dug ourselves into.
Okay, thank you. So I think it's about time to conclude, but to finish on an optimistic note, I'd like to ask you one last question that you could maybe answer in just a few sentences. So what do you think will be the most beneficial application of AI for our society in the coming decades?
All right, I'll start. I think the self-driving vehicle will be the biggest, and I think there is an aging population that will be immensely advantaged by the ability to move around, either if it's a scooter around the house or a car that drives them around. And I think it will be the same industry, the self-driving car industry, will be setting the standard of what AI actually means, what is morality, and so forth. So I think I'll put my shares of the future there.
Okay, so I can't take self-driving car, which might have been my first choice. So I'll choose my second choice, which is personalized medicine. So, I'd like to say to people, you could put on a smartphone diagnostic tools so that you could take first world healthcare and give it to the third world at almost no cost. And thousands of people are dying every day in the third world for diseases that we know how to diagnose and we know how to fix with pennies. And that's totally needless. And we have very soon the technology and the ability to solve that completely, and also to improve our own health. You know, that you'll be speaking to your doctor every day because your doctor will be on your smartphone and all the sensors and your Fitbit, everything that will be monitoring you, and that will make us all healthier, if not wealthier.
Well, on this, thank you to our both speakers.